Hi, I'm Mindy Tuzani. I am a certified transformational nutrition coach and yoga teacher. And I am here today with the amazing Dr. Stephanie Gray. So welcome, Dr. Stephanie.
Thanks for having me.
You're so welcome. I would love for you to share a little bit about your practice. Like, who do you help specifically?
Sure. So my husband, Eric, and I own the Integrative Health and Hormone Clinic. It's kind of a mouthful. We're in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, on the main road, right off Blairs Ferry Road. And we help patients with a lot of different problems. So I specialize with hormone optimization. So I don't want patients, you know, hormone levels to just be normal. We want them to be optimal to help with aging. We balance not just sex hormones, but thyroid hormones. We have a lot of women coming in with those issues. We work with chronic fatigue syndrome, see a lot of patients with gastrointestinal disorders, a lot of fibromyalgia, immune issues, especially autoimmune diseases like Hashimoto's, mood disorders, and we even see some cancer. So big slew of diseases.
Yeah.
A lot of people need help. Yeah.
I agree. Well, that's amazing. Yeah, you guys run the gamut on things that you help with. But your specialty is hormones, and it's balancing the hormones and getting them to an optimal level, not just so they feel like they're surviving, but that they're thriving.
Exactly. Yep. That's, well said.
That's amazing. So tell me a little bit more about yourself. Like how long ago, or like, how did you know that you wanted to be in the health field, and how did you get into, you know, integrative and functional?
Yeah, kind of a long story. I don't know. So I grew up in a family that, you know, always appreciated non-conventional approaches to health. So I don't even remember who my doctor was as a child, because I never really went to the doctor. We always went to the chiropractor. That's how I was raised. My parents were growing wheatgrass juice on the kitchen table before that was like popular, you know, to do. Taking vitamins and supplements and liquid chlorophyll and all kinds of things. And so I kind of grew up, I was blessed to grow up, you know, with that becoming part of my nature. Interestingly, I always wanted to be a doctor. Not that I think I really knew what a doctor was, but I wanted to help people. And so I ended up going to nursing school, mainly because it was less schooling than, you know, becoming a medical doctor. But I had planned to become a nurse practitioner because I knew in the state of Iowa, we have the opportunity to practice independently. So I knew, you know, I had the end goal of definitely having my own practice. Mm-hmm. So what got me interested in functional medicine, I'd say, was I worked in a nursing home as a certified nursing assistant. And, you know, nursing homes, we need nursing homes, but right. They can be a little bit of a depressing place. You know, they, unfortunately, a lot of people are who become admitted are losing a lot of function and mobility. And what I noticed is, you know, I was constantly toileting the residents, and it was really pretty sad. I had realized, you know, all day long, I'm essentially taking patients to the restroom and, you know, changing the kind of adult briefs and whatnot. And I recognized there was a lot of incontinence. And it was brought to my attention that that was one of the top reasons why these individuals were even being admitted to assisted living or long-term care facilities. And so I thought, okay, so if we can increase bladder control or increase continence, maybe some of these individuals could maintain more independence and stay in their homes longer. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, there's got to be another way. You know, there's got to be non-pharmacological, non-surgical interventions to help individuals maintain their independence, essentially. And so I became a certified continence nurse, and I appreciate that certification because I'm still using that, you know, in my practice mm-hmm. now. But that was just my first insight into, okay, there is a better way. There is a different way for these individuals. And so, again, I learned to help patients essentially with just bladder control, with Kegel, you know, pelvic strengthening pelvic floor muscle exercises, and even with pessary fittings. And so pessary fittings are kind of like a diaphragm. That's how I explain them to patients. They're intravaginal support device that kind of helps support what tissue could be prolapsing or falling down. The bladder can fall down, and you can actually feel it coming out of the vaginal vault, the intestines, you know, the rectum, the uterus, of course. And so some patients don't want to have surgery, or they've had surgery for their, you know, prolapse several times, and the prolapse is coming back. The recurrence rates are just astronomical. And so I got this continent certification, and I thought, okay, this is a different way. And little did I know there was another way, kind of the functional medicine approach for all health conditions, not just bladder control issues. So that's what first kind of piqued my interest.
Uh-huh.
And a patient gave me, it was a Life Extension magazine, that had, and I kind of flipped through it and I saw, you know, Suzanne Summers is going to be at this, you know, A4M, American Academy Anti-Aging Medicine Conference. and I could learn about bioidentical hormone replacement therapy. And so I said, I'm going. And I went and became addicted to all the information. And I just thought, this is it. This is my ticket. This is something different. This is how I can help people. And so I very shortly completed their health care diplomat, and then I enrolled in their advanced fellowship program. Mm-hmm. So I did the fellowship in anti-aging, regenerative, and functional medicine. And that's the knowledge that I've been able to apply here at this practice to help patients get to the root cause of their problem. So mm-hmm. I really appreciate both of those certifications. They opened my eyes, and yeah, we haven't stopped since. We just keep learning, keep mm-hmm. applying those concepts. So that's my story.
That's amazing. I love it. And did you also want to share like any personal struggles that you've had where you've applied those principles personally to, you know, overcome or reverse those symptoms?
Yeah. So I'm also obviously thankful for this knowledge because almost everyone is going to face health issues, they or their family members at some point in their life. And I definitely have struggled with some issues myself. And so for which conventional medicine couldn't find, you know, the root cause of the problem. So I don't even remember when this started. I've had palpitations, which are, you know, irregular heartbeats or more pronounced where you kind of feel like your heart's beating out of your chest. I've had palpitations for a long time, which, you know, sometimes after I work out pretty aggressively or whatnot, you know, I rest, they wouldn't be too problematic. I thought they were normal. Those are not normal. That's a symptom. Your body's trying to tell you something. Mm-hmm. And those palpitations turned into tachycardia, which is the medical term for very fast heart rate. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this would happen to me where my heart would just take off. I'd just be sitting at my desk and bing, 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 bing. My heart would literally take off. I'd feel like I was going to pass out. I actually went to the emergency room. I was lightheaded and dizzy and couldn't get my body to slow down. My body was in that, you know, fight or flight, that overdrive state. And I had a lot of pressure in my chest, unrelieved. Well, it would be relieved, I should say, with burping. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a lot of lower gastrointestinal symptoms, but had a lot of upper pressure. Mm-hmm. When I would burp, I, oh my gosh, I could breathe. I wasn't so short of breath. But then I would fill back up with air, essentially gas again. And so, you know, I had known I had a gluten sensitivity. I think most people do.
Yeah.
For years. And I had taken gluten about 80% out of my diet. But when this was happening, I went ahead and tested myself for celiac because, of course, gastroenterologist wanted to put me on proton pump inhibitors, reflux medication, mm-hmm. which I didn't think I needed. And my celiac testing was positive. I remember sitting in my office looking at my labs thinking, this is not mm-hmm. happening to me. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure that's what patients feel, you know, when we have to tell them they have to change their diet. I knew exactly how to do it. It was just, oh boy, this is a life, you know, it's going to be a life commitment. Uh-huh. I did get a biopsy. My biopsy was negative. So praise God, I didn't have a lot of damage to my intestines yet, but obviously I was on the way. And so removing gluten helped a lot. I mean, after that point, I 100%, you know, cut gluten out of my diet. Mm-hmm. I was so desperate and I was having, you know, so many GI issues. I took the proton pump inhibitor from the gastroenterologist. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes just that fear takes over. And I said, okay, I'll take the medication. And I, to this day, wish I never had because I developed SIBO, which is small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Mm-hmm. After taking it just a short period of time. So those medications block stomach acid, and stomach acid is extremely important to fight off infections. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, maybe I had a little SIBO brewing before I took the medication, but clearly that was the straw that broke the camel's back. Taking the medication, I then had SIBO and I was even more full of pressure in my chest.
Yeah.
So interestingly, I then ended up having fructose intolerance. So it's a lot more difficult to remove fructose and the FODMAPs foods, mm-hmm. but essentially the fermentable foods. I mean, even nuts are on the list. Garlic and onions are on that list.
Yeah.
This is way more difficult than taking gluten out. And so I feel blessed that I knew how to do that because of my training. And mm-hmm. I have been a lot better. I just don't have so much pressure. I'm not as short of breath.
Yeah.
But I think the major realization that hit me when my heart was racing is that I was way too stressed out. Uh-huh. You know, I had went to grad school 3 times. I worked full time, started a business. I was teaching part time in the nurse practitioner program, got married. I thought, oh, I'm Wonder Woman. You know, I can handle all this. Yeah, right. Uh-huh. We think we're getting by, and then our body sends us signals. You know, those palpitations were some of my first signals that I needed to slow it down. Like literally, my body couldn't handle any more stress.
Yeah.
My adrenals were like, yeah, they were shot. So. Uh-huh. through, you know, my symptoms and my individual research, since doctors really couldn't help me, all they want to do is, you know, put you on medications, I started looking into my genetics. And I found out a lot of genetic variants I had, one of which is COMT, mm-hmm. Which I have several of those variants, which increase my risk, you know, for stress and anxiety, just feeling like my adrenaline is rushing. I essentially had the perfect storm. Mm-hmm. I had the genes that were going to cause that feeling like my adrenaline was rushing. And then you add the lifestyle. Clearly mm-hmm. I was stressed out, and it was really the perfect storm. Mm-hmm. And a lot of patients who have those variants cannot handle caffeine or any stimulants. I mean, mm-hmm. I can't even smell coffee. I feel like my heart's going to, you know, take off. I can barely have any chocolate even to this day. And so I thought, gosh, if I have these genetic variants, I can't imagine what some of my patients have. And so, you know, the training I've had has benefited me, but then it's also benefited my patients, because then I think this patient has this genetic variant. I want to research and, you know, learn more about that. Uh-huh. And so I have learned, you know, some of the cofactors that I should be taking for those genetic variants, magnesium being one of them. I take magnesium religiously every day. I mean, I have to take magnesium. So it's been quite the journey. Mm-hmm. I learned to set boundaries and to try to slow down, reduce my patient load, take time for myself. So I just really appreciated your mindfulness and, you know, meditation series, you know, because that's what we all need to be doing. I didn't think I needed it. I thought I was handling everything. And I clearly wasn't. And so now I realize the importance of incorporating those every day to try mm-hmm. to meditate, you know, calm your mind. Not exercise. I mean, exercise is great. I ran 5 miles this morning, but that just gets my adrenaline, my cortisol up. Mm-hmm. I need to make sure I'm taking time to decrease mm-hmm. my cortisol, the deep breathing and meditation. And I need to make sure I'm doing both. And so, yeah, mm-hmm. that's kind of my personal story.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing. I really appreciate that. And yeah, you said a lot of things that people struggle with. I mean, like the palpitations, it might not be to that extreme, but a lot of people experience anxiety and the chest mm-hmm. pains, and it could be a variety of things, for sure. So like you said, it's important to do the testing to kind of dig to see what the root cause of that is.
And then it validates you too, because then you feel like, okay, you know, uh-huh. not that this is, I don't want to say normal, but it just validates you to know, okay, I do have these genetic variants. And so therefore this uh-huh. is what I have to do with my lifestyle. So right. those genes are not expressed. So
exactly.
The testing provides such a roadmap to really help with the decisions, you know, mm-hmm. patients can make and that providers can recommend for those patients. So.
Yeah, definitely. And you mentioned also, like, you had the bloating and like the pressure, which was mm-hmm. caused from SIBO, the small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, which yeah. a lot of people haven't heard
been
about
tested for. Yes.
Or been tested for. So yep. that's a simple thing, you know, with which you said you had reduced the gluten, but that was one of the triggers that triggered the SIBO.
And so, then yeah, I think, you know, my gut was not in as good of shape as it should have been. Mm-hmm. And I was even raised on probiotics. I mean, I was raised healthy, I feel like, you know, and I still haven't taken many antibiotics through my life. You know, I still mm-hmm. had these issues. And a lot of patients think, oh, if I just remove gluten because my neighbor did, I'm going to get better. Uh-huh. But that's not the case. You know, I removed the foods that my food sensitivity testing said I needed to remove. But for proper gut healing, you need to remove infections also. And that's mm-hmm. where I had to treat the SIBO, get rid of the SIBO, which I think also led to fructose intolerance. You know, I had three things going on, and the fructose foods, high fructose foods, didn't show up on my food testing, because the food testing is more, is looking at an immune reaction.
Uh-huh.
The fructose testing is looking for more malabsorption. You know, it's showing that I can't break down those sugars. And so a lot of patients, not that they're led astray, they just are never given the full answer, because no one has, mm-hmm. like you were saying, has dug deep enough to figure mm-hmm. out all their triggers. So mm-hmm. for me, I needed to essentially remove all of those, the fructose, the SIBO, and the gluten.
Right. So in your opinion, do you think you had the fructose malabsorption before you started the treatment for SIBO, or after the proton pump inhibitors?
It's a really interesting question, and I should go back and look at my log, because mm-hmm. I initially thought, oh, I had this, those darn antibiotics, you know, they mm-hmm. contributed to the fructose intolerance. But my husband thinks I've had it for a long time, because I've just never tolerated sugar alcohols, like xylitol is very healthy. You know, we sell it at the clinic.
Yeah.
I've never tolerated xylitol. I mean, I've just never tolerated a lot of sugar alcohols. And so it's, you know, there's a potential that I actually have had fructose intolerance a long time. So I may never know.
Yeah. So for those that might also have fructose intolerance, like what are some of the symptoms or signs that they can connect the dots between those? Yeah.
A lot of patients get diarrhea, and I didn't have that. Luckily, I didn't have the lower GI symptoms. I had more the upper. Mm-hmm. So some of the fructose intolerance symptoms are very similar to SIBO symptoms, belching, you know, burping, just a lot of that gas and pressure. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I knew I had fructose intolerance because I would put honey in my tea and immediately I would feel full and swollen and like I needed to burp. I mean, that honey, that natural sugar, I just could not tolerate. And so if you're suspicious that you have fructose intolerance, pay attention to how you feel when you have foods that are high in fructose.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and then see how you feel when you don't consume them. So
yeah,
I had the symptoms, but I clearly had strong indications after I had foods high in fructose.
Mm-hmm.
So just needed to get them out.
Yeah. And then the proton pump inhibitors, for those people that aren't familiar with what that is, like, do you have the brand or the name brand of or what?
Yeah. So the purple pill, if you've ever seen, you know, the heartburn commercials, like omeprazole, Prilosec, Nexium, a lot of the azoles, omeprazole, mm-hmm. a lot of the drugs that sound like that, those are the acid blocking medications. And there are times when they are needed, but oftentimes patients have low stomach acid. Now we need to be giving them hydrochloric acid, which we can actually assess for and test on a stool test to see if they're, you know, not breaking down proteins and fats and whatnot. We can test to see if they need enzymes or bile or hydrochloric acid. Mm-hmm. And that's what kind of makes us different, is that we personalize, you know, the approach to patients rather than just give everyone a proton pump inhibitor because they have reflux. Why don't we dig and figure out why the patient has reflux, you know, and improve or restore, you know, what they need so the symptoms will hopefully resolve.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's amazing. So yeah, there's a test for the small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. There's a test for stomach acid, the enzymes, and then you can kind of put all those things together. So that's beautiful that you listened to your body and you were able to dig and uncover those things and then make those tweaks to your diet and your lifestyle. So all of those symptoms could, you know, be relieved, be healed.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing. So now you've also incorporated some daily stress management tools.
You bet. Yeah. So it's part of my, you know, recommendations at the end here, the three things, but I put a sticky note on my door and say, I'm trying to meditate, right? Still working on mastering it, but it says trying to meditate, basically tells the staff to leave me alone for 10 minutes and maybe I'll only get 5 or 10 minutes, but I just sit there and I deep breathe and try to calm myself down over lunch. Because if I don't, it's just go, 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 fight or flight. And by the end of the day, I'm maxed out. So it's very important to take that time to calm things down. You know, some of us have desk jobs where maybe we're sitting all day. Others don't. And those who really are go, 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 you know, have that fight or flight need to really take the time to calm things down.
Mm-hmm. Because, yeah, that stress is one of the biggest triggers for
every disease. Yeah.
And it can decrease the stomach acid. And then, like you said, it can be one of those key triggers to all of those.
It can even impact genetic expression, you know, so it's a vicious cycle. But the more stressed I am, the more those bad genes are going to manifest or show up. The less stressed I am, hopefully I can keep some of those turned off. So it's a vicious cycle.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing.
Yeah.
So also, this is another really fun question, because I know you've helped, you know, you've been in business and practice for years now, and you've helped thousands of patients. So out of all of those patients, what are at least one of your most miraculous patient stories? Like, what were their symptoms, their struggles, and what kind of protocols did you help them with?
So we have several patients who just feel like they were a hot hormone mess and they finally have their life back. So one woman specifically came in after having a hysterectomy at age 28, and that might sound weird to have a hysterectomy at age 28, but it happens, you know, especially if patients have heavy bleeding, whatnot. So what that told me is that she had hormone imbalances way back when she was 28. Having the hysterectomy didn't fix her hormone imbalances, right? Mm-mm. Just took out the cause for the heavy bleeding. So she probably had low progesterone dating way back into her 20s. Anyway, she had a hysterectomy. She was put on Premarin, which is a synthetic estrogen for hormone replacement therapy, and it wasn't doing the trick. You know, she's having terrible hot flashes, night sweats. She felt lousy. And she was actually pretty mad that it took her so long to find our clinic. Finally, a friend had referred her. But at the same time, she was put on Synthroid for her thyroid, which is primarily a T4 medication, and she had terrible irritable bowel syndrome. And so she has an amazing testimony. You can even read it on our clinic website. But essentially, she said she was planning her life around her bowels. You know, she always had to know where the bathroom was. And her friends had gone gluten and dairy-free, so she thought that's what she needs to do, gluten and dairy-free. And that was part of her problem, but it wasn't all of her problem. So when we tested her, nuts and almond, peanuts, and eggs showed up. And once she removed those, her bowels nearly normalized. I mean, yes, we put her on a gut healing protocol and probiotics and all the good stuff, but she really needed to remove the triggers. Mm-hmm. And so she was so thankful, you know, that our motto is we don't guess, we test. She was so thankful that we were able to test for those foods. Mm-hmm. And then from a hormone standpoint, she needed T3. She was only on T4. She wasn't feeling like she was even on thyroid medication. You know, her fatigue, sluggish metabolism, cold intolerance, brain fog, you know, those symptoms weren't being improved by her medication. Mm-hmm. So we switched her over to Natrathroid, which is desiccated porcine. It has both T4 and T3. And she felt like something was clicking again. You know, her brain fog was disappearing. So she felt much better on that option, and her T3 level did improve. And then we absolutely took her off the synthetic Premarin. Mm-hmm. I actually switched her to hormone pellets. So pellets are, I believe, the safest way to take hormones. They're about the size of a little teeny grain of rice. And we numb up the kind of fatty tissue here, kind of above the bottom, but kind of lower back. Uh-huh. We numb you up just like the dentist would, just teeny little bit of lidocaine. And then we pop the pellets right under the tissue. And so we, again, stopped the oral synthetic Premarin, switched her to the pellet, estradiol, mm-hmm. and testosterone, and gave her the long-needed natural progesterone. And she said she's a different person. You know, she said she overheard her husband at a party telling her friends, or his friends, that a lot of the therapies aren't covered by insurance, but that he doesn't care how much it costs because she's a different person and she's not that hot hormone mess anymore. So she just, you know, has complimented our clinic because she has her life back. And that is the best feeling in the world when someone says they have their life back, and that we were able to play a role in that. You know, we tell patients they're the hero of their journeys, not us. We're the guide. We can tell you what to do. We can tell you to take eggs out of your diet, you know, but she had to make those changes. She had to want to switch over to hormone pellets and whatnot. And she made the change and she feels much better. So that's one example.
Mm-hmm. Wow. That's amazing. So yeah, she came in, she was 28, had a hysterectomy. Her hormones were a mess. You tested her hormones, you tested her thyroid, you tested her for food sensitivities. And so it was this whole combination of like taking out those food triggers that were causing imbalances and triggers, and then also correcting the balance of the thyroid messengers with that, and then doing the hormone replacement, taking it from synthetic to a more natural.
Yes.
So what I know that you've told me before, because you're the hormone expert, is, you know, Synthroid, it's from basically a mare,
an
animal?
Premarin. You're thinking Premarin.
Premarin.
Yeah, Premarin stands for pregnant mare's urine. Uh-huh. So yes, they actually, it's nasty. They take dehydrated horse urine and try to make some synthetic hormones out of that. And I don't think that's natural. Mm-hmm. I would want to take those hormones. I'd rather take something that's plant-based. That's what we give, yam-based hormones. Mm-hmm. Now, our bodies are much more likely to have fewer side effects and to accept that hormone because that chemical structure is much more similar to what we should be making. Mm-hmm. When we give ourselves synthetic drugs, obviously we are going down the road of potentially disaster. I mean, they might work, but they can also cause side effects and they're more difficult for our body to metabolize.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. So what are some of the side effects that she could have or anyone could have from some of those synthetic things?
The main issue with, second issue with Premarin, and not just that it's horse urine, which again, wouldn't want to take. She was taking a capsule, so she was swallowing it. And so that was having to be metabolized through her gut, right? Through her liver, whatnot, essentially be excreted. anything you take by mouth is subject to that first pass metabolism. We don't know how much is absorbing, how much is actually binding to receptors. And we think that's where increased risk of cancer and clotting can occur. So depending how the liver can metabolize those hormones, which we can test for that also, some patients metabolize things better than others, can determine her risk. Now, when we switched her to pellets, when we put the pellet in the backside here, you know, that's being metabolized by her kidneys. We're entirely bypassing the gut and the liver. So that those pellets are safe even for patients with clotting disorders, because those pellets do not increase, you know, risk for clots, because they're not being cleared through the liver. So it's a pretty brilliant design, great way to administer the hormones. And then again, we're bypassing the gut and the liver. Her problem also was that her hormones were very poor balanced. She had super high estrogen, which she didn't need because she's probably had high estrogen forever. And zero progesterone and testosterone. So we gave her testosterone also in the pellet, which I failed to mention. And then we raised her progesterone. So when patients are estrogen dominant, they can have a lot of weight gain, breast tenderness, heavy bleeding. She had a hysterectomy, so she didn't have the bleeding. But they can feel pretty lousy. When we balance the hormones, patients tend to feel much better. Progesterone is the most soothing, calming hormone. It's great for anxiety and sleep. And a lot of menopausal women come in with sleep disorders and anxiety, and they need progesterone, and they have not been given it. Doctors give them Premarin without even testing their levels. So they need to have their levels tested so that we can confirm, you know, what the patients need. I had one patient with terrible hot flashes come in. Her estrogen levels were like over 1,000. It was one of the highest I'd ever seen. Her gynecologist had put her on synthetic estrogen. She did not need estrogen. That was the worst thing that she could have been given. She needed progesterone and she needed testosterone. So that particular case, I detoxed. I mean, we put her in liver detox. We stopped the estrogen, obviously. Her estrogens came down to a more reasonable level. And we boosted her progesterone and testosterone. So that just echoes the importance of testing for these patients.
To see the numbers and to help either correct the imbalances or give them more if they're completely depleted.
Yes.
Yeah, that's so great.
We had another patient who, I mean, she really had such significant mental health issues that she was on several medications. When she would come to our office, she would almost shake. I mean, she was having panic attacks very frequently, and we discovered her hormone levels were really low. And simply balancing, and I should say optimizing her hormone levels, her psychiatrist was like, "What have you done to this patient? You know, we've tried all these medications with no success." She's had a tremendous physical transformation. I mean, we can see it when she walks in the clinic. She is a better person, and she can now spend time with her grandkids and enjoy, you know, her husband. And that wasn't the case before. She's now off most of her medications. And so even from a mental health standpoint, hormones are so important.
Wow. And then you had another patient story too you wanted to tell?
Sure, I'll just keep sharing if you let me know.
Okay.
Maybe we'll transition to another issue that we help, which is chronic infections. You know, so we do test for Lyme disease, we test for yeast overgrowth, whatnot. And I had one patient with very severe yeast overgrowth. She had been on Diflucan or fluconazole. That's a medication a lot of women have taken. You know, they take maybe one or two pills if they have a vaginal yeast infection. Well, she was taking this weekly to control rashes. So she had rashes around her belly button, under her armpits, essentially anywhere moisture would collect. Pretty bad rash. And so a conventional medicine's approach was keep taking Diflucan the rest of your life, which can be very difficult, very hard on the liver. And a lot of patients that I've seen have Diflucan resistance. You know, they've taken Diflucan so long, it's not even helping with their yeast. And so we do have tests. We can test to see if patients have Diflucan or other medication resistant yeast so that we can better select the right agent for them. But this patient, we put on a natural antifungal protocol. We overlapped it with the Diflucan. And we also, because Diflucan was actually a good choice for her, we revved up her Diflucan to daily for a few months. She had to make dramatic diet changes to get sugar out of her diet, you know, quit feeding the yeast. Doctors should be recommending that, you know, when they're recommending Diflucan. We did a stool test on her as well. And what we were able to do with her is get her rashes under control. So we put her on a pretty aggressive protocol for months. I mean, it was months. This doesn't get cured overnight. And now we're weaning her down. So my goal is eventually to get her entirely off Diflucan, but she doesn't have rashes anymore. So she is just elated with the progress that she's had. And so we'll continue to work with her, and she may need a maintenance, you know, she may need to take natural antifungals, potentially for the next couple of years. I mean, it could take a long time to keep this under control. Mm-hmm. I think her success is going to be partially dependent on how compliant she is with her diet changes.
Right.
And that's up to her. So time will tell, but that was a great, just a great yeast testimony. You know, yeast can not just cause rashes, but it can cause bloating, inability to lose weight, tons of brain fog. A lot of times it'll cause the little cracks in the corners of the mouth. It can cause a very thick, coated, furry looking tongue. So I always look at my patient's tongue to see, oh, does this patient need a probiotic? What's going on in their gut? It's probably manifesting in their tongue, so I can at least get a little reflection of gut health by looking in their mouth. Mm-hmm. So yeast is certainly something we treat here.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, vaginal yeast infections and overgrowth of yeast in the gut, so much so that it shows up on their tongues or cracks in their mouth.
It can even be in their sinus cavities. I have a lot of patients who have chronic sinus infections. They've had sinus surgeries, several sinus surgeries. I mean, continuous surgeries, and no one's ever looked to see if yeast are growing in these deep, dark, moist sinus cavities. You know, we have a lot of treatment options for those patients, one being a silver nose spray. They spray the silver up into those sinus cavities several times a day to try to keep the yeast under control. So yeast can be difficult to treat, but it can be conquered.
And so the main cause that you've seen for yeast is too much sugar in the diet?
And definitely antibiotic use. I mean, some patients have, you know, as a teenager, they took antibiotics for acne. Maybe they had a lot of urinary tract infections that they took antibiotics for, or maybe they took it for sinus infections. So maybe they needed the antibiotics initially, but not multiple rounds of them. And unfortunately, those antibiotics were just feeding yeast in the sinuses. So those are usually the top reasons I see patients take antibiotics for. But
did you have her take any probiotics along with removing sugar from her diet?
You bet. Yes. Some of these patients don't tolerate probiotics very well. And even like when I had SIBO, I didn't tolerate them well either. So, you know, probiotics are a great idea, but they need to be using it cautiously. You also don't want to give patients a Herxheimer reaction or a really strong yeast die-off. So you have to time the probiotics, you know, appropriately. And if you're on an antibiotic, you don't want to take the antibiotic with the probiotic because the antibiotic will kill the probiotic. So yes, we do use targeted probiotic therapies, different doses, different strains, different times of the day, pending what the patient can tolerate.
So yeah, that's great. And I'm sure you do some testing and it's very targeted. So that's good. So you don't just recommend someone just to eat a bunch of yogurt or to just get any old probiotic off the shelf at a store?
No, I mean, sometimes I might recommend they take a basic probiotic, you know, if they don't have any major health issues, but doing the stool test will help tell us if the patient needs lactobacillus or bifidobacter species, or maybe they need a different species. So testing, again, helps to personalize that therapy. So we test as many patients as let us. You know, if they don't want to pay for the testing or whatnot, I'll make some basic recommendations, but normally patients who are pretty sick want answers. So testing's the best way to get those.
Agreed. That's awesome. That's wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing all those, those stories. And it's so crazy because a lot of people out there, they have all of these symptoms and it's like they're, you know, go to doctors and they're like, oh, you know, try this, try that. And then it's hard because then it might dig them into a deeper hole. But I just love how you do the testing and you listen and you do, you know, make custom protocols to them to try to, you know, uncover the root cause and to peel back all of those layers. That's amazing.
You bet.
And then out of all of the things that you do personally or the top things that you recommend, what are the top three tips that you have to share?
Sure. Well, I love sleep. Everyone that knows me knows sleep. That's pretty much my favorite thing. I love naps also. And that's one thing that I had major lack of when I was having tachycardia. I mean, I couldn't even lay down flat because my heart was just taking off and soaring and it was keeping me up all night. I felt like I went months without sleeping. I'm sure I slept more than I thought, but you have to have quality rest time. You can't work till midnight and get up at 5 or 6. It just, your body needs more than that. And so I absolutely recommend good high quality sleep, and you might need some supplements to help with that. And there are certain tests we can do. Maybe it's even hormones that you need. Maybe you need progesterone to help sleep. But I think part of obtaining quality sleep involves reducing stress too. So maybe, you know, you need to do the meditation at night to calm your brain at night so that you can turn off all the blue lights, get all the stimulation out mm-hmm. so that you can get high quality sleep. So I think sleep, and then I'm tying that into managing stress, are so important. I mean, probably the best thing you could do for your health every single day is something to manage stress. And I keep bringing up meditation because that was great for me. You know, the deep breathing and the meditation, getting oxygen through my body. Maybe for another, it's yoga. You know, you have to find something that works for you, but incorporating stress reduction techniques are just so important. And because I've had to incorporate those, I think that's my number one, because I've seen the most success from that. So that'd be my number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, because I'm so passionate about hormones, I recommend everyone get their hormone levels tested. Mm. You know, I have 50 and 60 year olds who come in with low hormones and they think, well, when did my hormones fall? When did my, you know, problems go awry? When did my levels drop? Mm-hmm. And I wish everyone would have their levels tested in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, so we could see subtle changes. We could see if progesterone is dropping in the 30s, so we could intervene and help the body make more before you just start having panic attacks and anxiety and sleep issues and whatnot. If you get your levels tested sooner, I think that's a great investment in health. So having your hormone levels assessed would be number two. And then number three, you know, find a functional medicine practitioner who can help. So there are a lot of great, you know, social media avenues that you can learn from, a lot of fancy websites. But a functional medicine practitioner can really help you navigate your challenges. So they can usually, you know, order the testing that needs to be ordered to help discover your root cause of the problem. And then they can prescribe medication if needed, or obviously other supplements and nutraceutical products to help you get back to health. So I think a lot of patients get frustrated and they try to do this on their own based on their own internet research. And a lot of patients are right. They've found their problem, you know, but they need a functional medicine practitioner to guide them along that journey. And so I, regardless of where you live, you know, my recommendation would be to find a functional medicine practitioner who can help guide you along your journey, either getting you back to health or help with preventative medicine so you don't get sick in the first place. So that would be number three, really finding a well-trained practitioner to help.
Awesome. I love it. So it's sleep, getting good quality sleep and managing stress so you can sleep.
Yes.
And your body can heal, and then testing your hormones.
Yes.
So even in your 20s, testing your hormones, I guess a lot of, you know, 20-year-olds, you know, that don't have as many symptoms are probably like, no, I don't know. But even like for those women that have like heavy periods or PMS or those, you know, like, or acne, like getting their hormones tested would do wonders for them. I wish I would have known about medicine and testing hormones back then, instead of just being like, oh, I'll just take the pill, because that caused a lot of chaos. So I love that tip of getting your hormones checked, no matter what age you are.
I think a lot of patients are surprised to know how low their hormone levels are. And they want to know, well, when I was feeling great in my 20s, where were my levels? You know, maybe their levels were at 1,000. And that's where they feel the best. Maybe their levels were only 600. I don't know. But it would be good for them to have known, you know, what level they need to get to really feel their best. And so having that data, tracking that, my engineer patients always track their data, but, you know, not everyone else does. So again, having that data, maybe you're past that age, someone who's listening, but maybe for Christmas, you can get your children hormones, hormone levels tested. It's a great gift.
Yeah,
so I mean, they wouldn't know where they're sitting currently.
Exactly. Your hormones are your body's messengers. So you need your messengers to be in the right order. Simple hormone test. And then number three was finding a functional medicine doctor. So I absolutely agree with that, because, you know, all through, you know, my past, I tried the conventional way of a pill for ill, and sure, it might have worked sometimes, but overall, I could have reversed a lot of symptoms and diagnoses in the future. So yeah, functional medicine, it's getting to the root cause, getting all of the testing, and making simple lifestyle changes. So that way, you know, people aren't stuck on all of these prescriptions and getting more side effects and getting sicker and sicker. It's saying, stop, let's look at this. Let's find the root so you can thrive instead of just survive.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for sharing all of your story, your patient stories, and all of your top tips. Is there anything else you can think of that you want to share?
Well, I have a book coming out. So mm-hmm. this will be my first major publication book-wise. Uh-huh. It's called Your Longevity Blueprint. So right now we're scheduled for it to be published December 1st. Might come mm-hmm. out sooner, maybe a little later. We wanted to get it out by the holidays. And so I'm comparing, I'm really within the book, I'm drawing an analogy between how you would build a house. You need a foundation, you need the structure, you need the electrical work and the plumbing and yada, 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 good roof, right? I'm drawing that analogy to the body. And so we're talking about different organ states. You know, one of the chapters is obvious on hormones, which I'm comparing to the heating and cooling system of the house. Another chapter is on, you know, proper gut health. That's really the foundation. Your spine is more of the framework, right? So I have those 10 steps in the book. I won't share them all right now, but I'd love for you to grab the book when it comes out. Correlating with the book launch, we will also be launching a new supplement line. Mm-hmm. So I will let you wait on that.
Awesome.
Coming soon. Yeah.
Awesome. I'm so excited. I'm so excited for the book. I'm definitely going to get that. And for the product line too, to go along with all of those solutions. That's really exciting.
So I'm also taking Dr. Richie Shoemaker's Chronic Inflammatory Response Syndrome Certification course, which is a big mm-hmm. mouthful.
Yeah.
But essentially, you know, living in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, we've had several floods here. I have a lot of patients who I know have been exposed to water damaged buildings and who I think are suffering potentially from symptoms of biotoxins. So these could be from bacterial toxins or even mold toxins. And I, you know, we've balanced their hormones, we fixed their gut, and we're missing something. And I do believe that they need to get these biotoxins out of their life, literally. And so that's what I'm learning to do in this certification course. It's going to be a long program, but I'm hoping to be able to incorporate what I'm learning this year into the practice and really hope to help those patients. We see patients from all over. We have patients who come for pellet therapy. We were the first clinic in Iowa to start administering the BioT hormone pellets. So we also see patients over the phone for phone consults. So if you are in need of help, you know, do not postpone your recovery. Mm-hmm. Seek out, either find a local functional medicine practitioner or check out our website and you can download new patient paperwork and we'd be happy to see you from a distance.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Awesome. I'm so proud of you. And I am so grateful to have met you and know you. And I will definitely be getting your book when it comes out. I'm so excited to see that. And yeah, I'll have a link in the show notes so people can find your website and they can connect with you if they'd like to see you or either see you in person in Cedar Rapids or do some phone work too. So thank you.